Our next speaker is Dr. Ali Haravandi, and he's going to talk to us about the irrigation puzzle, about sourcing water for golf courses. We've talked a lot about water use today, but we haven't talked quite a bit about the use of recycled water, and that's where Dr. Haravandi excels, and he's going to give us some the primary question is not whether you have to switch to recycled water recycled irrigation, but how you can access recycled water. So that's the challenge that's out there for many. Ali?
Thank you, Kim, and thank you for being here, ladies and gentlemen. It's a great pleasure to be here, and certainly an honor to be able to share with you a bit of information which I hope will be of practical use to you. My good friend, Mr. Jim Moore, call him good friend, remember, scheduled me for what time? Right in the middle afternoon, after lunch, before the break. Half of you are probably already dozing off. The rest of you are probably looking forward to do so. So, what I have decided to do is to tell you a story to help some of you to wake up, and the rest of you who want to take a nap, get it started, okay? Before we get into our presentations. Long time ago, many, many years ago, in a galaxy far, far away. In a galaxy, actually the mother of all galaxies. There were two people living there, Grandpa Adam and Grandma Eve. You all have heard of that. And in that galaxy, it just happened that there was a big garden. They called it paradise. And it was all theirs. Mr. or Mrs. God, whatever you believe, has given it to them and said, this is yours with everything in it. You can do anything you want to do. Everything in it is all yours. Have a great time. But remember, don't eat the apple. Remember that, or fig, or pomegranate, or grape, or wheat, whatever you believe in. Whatever it was, don't do that. We won't do that. They were having a great time. They were alone and going on. But guess what? When you tell your kids one thing, don't do what they want to do, the first thing, as soon as they're not looking, they want to do that. And apparently, Grandma Eve just simply could not contain herself. For whatever reason, she ate one of those things, and it tasted good. Those angels, we call them angels, were jealous of these two really lucky people, Grandpa Adam and Grandma Eve. They went and told Mr. God or Mrs. God, they are doing it. What? Oh, they are eating it. He came and looked at them and said, didn't I tell you do not eat that apple? Grandma Eve started crying, and Grandpa Adam, oh, please forgive me, it wasn't his fault, it was the snake or something else. They wanted to come up with all kinds of excuses. Now, Mr. God said, no, that's not right, get out of here. He kicked them out of paradise, put them on a big spaceship, sent them to a totally different galaxy. Poor Grandpa Adam and Grandma Eve, they were all scared. Where are we going to go? You know, what is going to be and everything? And as their spaceship got closer and closer, they saw this beautiful little globe hanging in the sky with all kinds of colors, blue and white and green. It looked fantastic. It was actually better looking than they were before. They landed, and it was a beautiful place, the paradise of all paradise. Clouds would gather, snow will come down, the rain will come down, accumulate in reservoirs and lakes, and there were plants, and the weather was just fantastic. Snow would melt, go down to the lakes and seas, and everything come down, and it was beautiful. No TV, no internet, no golf, nothing. They were having a great time, and they were all They had it all to themselves. They didn't have to worry about up there somebody's watching them or not. It just happened that, unfortunately, there were more apple trees in that place than they had in before. So guess what they did? Start eating. And before they knew it, they made 7.5 billion of us. And they taught us, their kids, keep doing it. It's a good thing. and we are doing it. And for all practical purposes, with all the numbers I have, within a few years, there are going to be more than 8.5 billion of us on this planet Earth. And by the year 2050, from what I understand, it's going to be close to 13, 14 billion of us. We are eating apples faster than ever, and we are enjoying it like you wouldn't believe. All indications are that the majority of these people will be living in metropolitan areas, big cities. And majority of golf courses are located where? That's where they are. Unfortunately, these people, 7.5 billion of us, we are not just content with just a little bit of water drinking and do other stuff. We need water for our washer and dryer and showers and tubs and brushing our teeth and of course, home lawns, golf course, you know, swimming pools, or so on and so forth. So, unfortunately, aside from being so many of us, we are using much more water than our ancestors did. When our grandpa, grandmas were around and they were just having a great time and maybe once in a while kill an animal and eat them or something, they needed only 3, maybe 5 gallons of water a day. A little bit to drink, the rest of it just wash off the blood or something like that. According to USGA data right now, modern American, every one of us, are using between 80 to 100 gallons of water a day. Too many of us, and we are using more water. You have seen this picture today several times. Droughts are here to stay with the oil with us. For the past 35 years I've been in this business, almost every year we have a drought someplace in this country. And the frequency is becoming, droughts are becoming more frequent to larger areas. It's not going to go away. They're going to have that. So now we have more people, we are using more water, we don't have adequate amount of water. And this issue was discussed this morning later. When there is a problem, when there is a shortage of any type, society as a whole, and we are a part of that society, by the way, give that water or other resources for essential uses. And for you golfers, you know it. It's not a bad news, it's a news. You're not essential. When water is not around, the first thing that cities do, close parks and golf courses. As we have seen, we have heard many times, and that was the case in Colorado a few years ago when they had the their drought of 2002. So, unfortunately, now we have a problem. Too many of us using too much water and not enough water, and we are dealing with an activity, an amusement, or something that the great majority of people do not see as essential. Another thing has happened within the past 25, 30 years, and we have heard about this morning quite a bit. Early baby boomers and the rest of us, I think most of us fall within that category, have been moving into the warmer climates, arid areas, primarily desert states, Arizona, Nevada, Southern California, or so on. And of course, there, unfortunately, you can't really see these pictures very well. It's the annual rainfall in Las Vegas area is about how much? 1 inch? 4 inches. It is the desert of all deserts. Next time you fly over Las Vegas or Phoenix or Tucson, it doesn't matter. Look at the surrounding area, and we have built these houses. I don't know if you can see here within that very small section of Las Vegas, I'm pretty sure Doug knows exactly where they are, there are easily 10 golf courses. Yes, they were all developed because of the development housing or so on, and if it wasn't because of the economy, you probably would have three times as many in that area. Things have slowed down. Unfortunately, some of them have gone bankrupt. But it's not really a problem here in this country. It's just, we're all humans. This whole idea of we want to go there and let take the water with us has been around for a very long time. Many of you have traveled in Europe and other part of the country, other part of the world. You have seen ancient wells and aqueducts and reservoirs and canals and so on and so forth. In fact, I grew up in an area very close to where a series of these canals, some of you may have heard of them. When you fly over, you look down, there is this kind of a snake-shaped like little volcanoes, you would see them from the sky. Those are all the signs of what happened 2,500 years ago. We're talking about 500 BC. During Cyrus the Great, they were making this to bring the water from some aquifer hundreds of miles away by digging these little wells and connecting them together. I'm talking about really, really 100 miles. I was born there. I grew up there. I had my youth time there, and I've seen those. It's amazing how much trouble they went through to bring water from an area that was not probably a place to live to area they wanted to live, whether they wanted to use it for agriculture or so on. And the interesting thing is that we are not talking about large amount of water. Think about the amount of work went into making this, just moving water around. This is one of those wells fairly close to the spring. We're talking about really a trickle of water coming down 100 miles away. Fortunately, evaporation is basically nothing. And then many of these sites, which are still there, it's just like a temple. They are real water temples. It could be a church or a synagogue or a mosque or whatever, because how precious water is. Now, we are doing, obviously, kind of the same thing at much larger extent. Probably it's not sustainable anymore. Most of the water we have on Earth is basically useless to us at this time. Majority of it is in oceans and atmosphere, saline water. We have some in the polar caps. Unfortunately, they are melting very quickly, too. Of all the waters we have on Earth, the waters which are readily available to us, I'm talking about surface water in the streams, lakes, reservoirs, so on, is a very, very small amount, 0.02% of all that water. Yes, we can convert other waters into usable form, but that requires energy. And unfortunately, that energy is not neither cheap nor readily available, especially after what happened in Japan and their nuclear facility. So we are not going to have that energy very, very soon. So majority of energy we will probably need to convert the other waters into usable form is fossil fuel, which, aside from being expensive, causes other problems. So up to now, these are the main sources of water we have used for irrigation in golf courses and other landscape sites: domestic city lines, wells, canals, rivers, lakes, and reservoirs. Mr. Lyman actually did a fantastic job in presenting the information regarding their survey. And I've borrowed one of those tables here, Greg, with your permission, to look at this a little bit closer related to the sources of water we have for golf courses nationally and regional areas, and compare recycled water use to other sources of water. Again, nationally, again, about 52% of the golf courses mentioned they are using surface water. Very makes sense. 46% they have their wells, but 17% they use rivers and canals. Municipal use about 14%. Recycled water is about 12%. Nationally, we are getting very close to be using the same amount of water from those two sources. One thing which I was really surprised, and I don't know if Greg is around or not, that I noticed that in Southwest, we are still using 31% of water is domestic water. I was surprised to see that number. Pat, what do you think? Do you think that's accurate? And that is a kind of a sad commentary, as far as I'm concerned. We are living in an area where we have mentioned we don't have enough adequate amount of rain. We have too many people, and we are still using that. And that is going to change, obviously. It's not that cheap either. Of course, the same area, we are using recycled water at the highest amount of 37%. So again, and there are a few other degraded sources of water, brackish water, shallow wells, or so on, but the amount is fairly, fairly small. There is no doubt that the amount of municipal and well water use will go down, whether it is regulation or just simply not being available or just too expensive, and the only other source we have right now, as far as I'm concerned, kind of a viable source that we should look into using more is recycled water. Recycled water, as was mentioned before, it's also known as reclaimed. We used to call it effluent water and reuse water, sewage water, or so on. But it's basically a water which has been used by us once, at least showering, cooking, or whatever, and eventually sending it to a sewage treatment plant, which goes through a series of processes to produce a water, which up until recently was only treated to be discharged into the environment, just simply take all the pathogens out of it so people don't get sick. Fortunately these days, because we all have learned that this is a precious resource and we should not waste it, many of the treatment plants have upgraded their system, and we are producing very good quality recycled water in most part of the country, definitely in the southwest Florida, and I think that's going to happen in the rest of the country too. The least quality water which can be used for golf course irrigation is called secondary effluent, and that is a sewage which has gone through a biological process in which majority of organic matter has been decomposed, and of course before they release it, they somehow disinfect it using various methods, and it's available. But great majority of the waters we have right now available for golf courses, and they are very good quality, are tertiary, and in some cases actually we have cleaner than that, reverse osmosis or so on. And basically what treatment plants do, they take this very foul-smelling soup of sewage, which, by the way, when it goes to a treatment, how many of you have been to a sewage treatment plant before? Why? But anyways, you have gone there. So you went. I have a reason to go. Why? You know, oh, it was a weekend, it's free, the kids, you know, I'm interested, dude. I know somebody there, you know, they invited us to go there, had a picnic or something. But anyways, So almost all of you have been there. You know, when you go there, you don't see things that you can recognize. Because remember, that water has gone through miles and miles and miles and pipes and everything, but what you see is simply a very dirty, foul-smelling, dark water. And once in a while, depending on which city you are, you may see a few things that you recognize. But basically what happens, they take that water and convert it to something like this. Clean, clear, no smell to it. It looks so good. You want to jump in and swim or something, or have a drink. In fact, many of these places, I don't know if the places you went there, you probably noticed engineers offered you a glass of water to drink, and they drink it, and thank you very much. I appreciate it. It's good water. Now, I used to start thinking about this water 30 years ago. In fact, the first little pamphlet I wrote about this, I was very negative because we had very low quality water then. Now, I am 100% proponent, and I think this is a resource that we have to really pay attention to and utilize. However, there are problems. In case of recycled water, it is not what you can see, that it's what you cannot see you have to worry about. For golf course irrigation, for irrigation in general, it doesn't make any difference. Anytime you put that water on soil on any plant, you have to be aware that there are things dissolved in that water. You cannot see it, but they're there. You have to evaluate them, because unfortunately, and generally we call them dissolved salts, but that could be sodium, chloride, boron. There's no time to get into too much detail on that. Unfortunately, some of these salts, when they accumulate in the soil, can cause basically ruin the soil structure, or they could be picked up by plants and create problems, injury to plants to various levels. Collectively, we call them salinity problem, but it could be called by salts or sodium and some toxic ions, chloride, boron. You can actually change the pH of the soil, that can create problem. And as you can imagine, these waters have quite a bit of nutrients in them. It's a good resource, but we have to be aware of this. We have to evaluate them, learn about them, and hopefully use them efficiently and effectively, as many golf courses do. If you don't, then of course those salts are going to gradually accumulate in the soil and injure the plants, or the soil could become very impermeable to water and an air infiltration. Plants are going to suffer. You're not going to create drainage. And certainly other plants in the golf course may be affected by these salts as well, depending on the type of plant material you have there. Nutrients, something we always hear about, one of the selling points for recycled water producers. Oh, you have lots of nutrients and that's great. Yes, nitrogen could be fairly high, as well as phosphorus and potassium and some other micro nutrients or elements. In fact, in many cases, golf courses that I have worked with, we have been able to eliminate fertilization of almost all the roughs and a big portion of fairways. And that's a good thing. The problem, however, is that we have to remember that those nutrients, nitrogen and phosphorus and potassium, they are nutrients for a totally another group of plants as well. And those are what we refer to as algae. Almost all golf courses have some area where they hold most water for a while. And if those ponds or reservoirs are fed by recycled water and water stays there for a long time, you can have some algae problem. And of course, that's a cost to deal with. Fortunately, however, because we know about that and because we have learned or we have various means to deal with that, these days, many of the new golf courses, either new construction or reconstruction, they are built in that into the design of the golf course, so recycled water is treated further and therefore reduce the algae bloom, despite the fact that you may have nitrogen. So we are learning about this waters. We have developed criteria on evaluating these waters, and we have learned how to deal with these situations. There are books written on the topic. There are numerous number of articles. There are quite a few people in this room have done quite a bit of work in this area. We have better equipments. We have a long list of various amendments of different type that we can use. We have tools. On top of that, we have better quality to deal with. For example, blending. If your water is not a good quality water, it could be blended with another source of water to reduce the problems. Obviously, if you have a salinity problem, and as most of you know, the only way you can get rid of salts from the soil is to leach it out, which basically means that apply extra water for leaching purposes. And as it was mentioned earlier, I think Doug mentioned that yes, you will need more water if you're using recycled water for that leaching purpose. In some areas, you may have to install drain lines. If the soil does not drain and you are okay with domestic water or other sources of water, if you go to recycled water, which, by the way, almost all recycled waters will always have more salts in them than great majority, almost definitely domestic waters, but more than most of the wells and canals and others. There are a few cases where actually some of the shallow wells may have more salt, but that is something you have to be aware of. You may have to rebuild some part of the golf course, namely greens, in order to accommodate for that, and certainly looking into other grasses which are much more salt tolerant, and of course you have to learn about various amendments. We have, quite a bit of information to help superintendents to evaluate their water quality based on the established criteria, whether it's safe or not safe, and if it is not safe, what can we do to mitigate the problem. Fortunately, for especially golf greens and tees and sports facilities, we have several very effective way of building those to accommodate the salinity problems. The USGS system is one, the California system is one, many other sand-based root zones that have been developed within the past several decades actually are very, very useful for that purpose. Because, as I mentioned, we want to leach the salt out as much as we can. As I mentioned, the only way you can get rid of the salt in recycled water is to leach it out. For that, you must have drainage. If you do not have natural drainage, you must install drain lines. Now, that could be costly, but it's not impossible. It's just a matter of whether you want to have that water or not. And if that is the only source you have to pay for some of the consequences. Reclaiming saline soils is not a very complicated science. You just simply have a situation like this. If you have the investment and you're willing to do it, you install your drain lines after a couple of years, and if you're lucky, you get quite a bit of rain, you can leach that salt away and end up with a fairly good surface to play on. So these are some of the things that we already have at our disposal to allow us use the recycled water more efficiently. The other thing is we have many more choices of different grasses. Again, USGA has been really, and Gulf Coast Superintendent Association, these two organizations have spent quite a bit of money in developing grasses which are much more suitable for these conditions. Seashore paspalum, everybody knows that. And definitely in the warm climates, you can put any kind of saline water on it, and it can take it very well. These days, again, USGA is sponsoring more grass developments, salt grass, which could be actually used in a little bit more colder climates, with very, very salt tolerant, is in development, and my hope is that, and I guess Mike Kenna later on will tell us if we are any close in releasing some of those strains for golf purpose or others. My hope is that there is another grass, and I always like to encourage people to look into that, the alkali grass, Puccinellia species, extremely salt tolerant. My hope is that one of these days somebody will pick up that grass and run with it, because for extreme north we need something much more cold tolerant. As I mentioned earlier, we have a very large list of various chemicals, amendments available at our disposal, from any kind of a chemical to deal with sodicity. We have much more effective wetting agents. We have growth regulators. We have hormones of different type. They're all available, and we can certainly use those to accommodate our needs. Equipments. There are a large array of different equipments which is at our disposal. Here is a golf course, Metropolitan Golf Course, next to Oakland Airport, built on an old city dump. Grass grows on the sludge or sediment that they dredge from the San Francisco Bay to make an estuary, one of the harshest places to grow grass on. And they are growing grass on that with recycled water. But of course, he has to have how many equipment pieces he has, Pat? I think maybe five or six different types. But he's growing grass very, very effectively and very efficiently. So we have those. Now, one thing that has been a major concern for everybody, and now I think this morning again was mentioned, we have devices that can actually measure certain chemicals to such minute amount that about 10 years ago we weren't even thinking about it. 1 trillion or even more, smaller than that. The main concern right now, of course, is that, okay, recycled water may have, aside from salt or nitrogen or so on and so forth, what would happen to some of these chemicals? We're talking about personal care products, all the things we put in our body, pharmaceuticals of different type. They all eventually end up in the sewage. And apparently, the traditional treatment processes they use do not decompose or get rid of most of those materials. And some of these, especially hormone or endocrine disruptors or so on, at very, very minute amounts can have significant impact on the environment, whether it's in groundwater for human drinking or surface water for aquatic life or so on. So that is an area where there is quite a bit of concern. However, fortunately, the research was just completed. It was a 4-year project, multi-state, California, Arizona, Nevada, New Mexico, anyways, Southwest, and it was funded by golf industry as well as a couple of other organizations, Water Reuse Association, as well as WERF, Water Environmental Research Foundation. Some of you may have heard of them. This report is out. It's available from their websites. Google their names and find out. You go there. This basically showed that of 14 different personal care material and pharmaceuticals that they applied or they used in that project, very few of them passed the turf grass root zone, which basically, again, prove that turf grass is by far the best vegetation for recycled water irrigation. It further cleans this communal waste and sends something cleaner below the root zone. So that was encouraging as far as I'm concerned. This is a thick report. You can download it and look at that. So that problem is somehow solved for us, but we probably need to look further. By the way, this morning there was a mention, I think, Doug, you mentioned about the gray water and water harvesting and the effect on the amount of recycled water which will be available. Not only if everybody decide to do gray water captured and to use them at home, not only the recycled water quantity will be less, but the quality of it would be worse. It will be much more concentrated. So although we want people to conserve, but as far as our work is concerned, I think that if everybody in the country decides to use gray water, capture the liquid from their sewage, I think we're going to be in trouble. The reason I thought of that, because WERF just recently published another report on a specific use of gray water at home. It is, again, another thick report. You can download them. It's free, and I worked with them on their committee, and I think that's a very good one to be aware of. Regarding the health issues, other things that have happened, labeling could be a problem, costly for golf course. To my knowledge, everywhere in the country, if you are using recycled water for irrigation, you must have labels. You must let people know what you are doing, just in case something goes wrong at the plant. And of course, signs should be everywhere. This color purple has become the official color, in some states, the official color of recycled water use, although they haven't decided on the shade of purple. I've seen anywhere from red all the way to blue, and they call that purple. So that's beside the point. But the good thing, however, is that the irrigation industry has responded fantastically. You can find almost any piece of equipment related to irrigation in this color. And of course, as far as I'm concerned, when I'm working with some landscape architects or golf course architects, I encourage them to put purple down. All of them should be purple. There's no law against using purple color for domestic water, but I know sooner or later there will be recycled water coming to your neighborhood, and then you don't have to change anything. So we see more and more of this. And by the way, quite often you'll see this purple, but that doesn't always mean that water is recycled. It's just a smart move on their part, and I'm glad they are doing that. I wrote an article, and I would like to propose to you, and I hope you will spread the word. This is, as far as I'm concerned, a resource that we have to be a little bit more serious about utilizing it and using it more efficiently and effectively. It is the purple gold, as far as I'm concerned. You all have heard of the black gold, which is oil, and blue gold. Why not purple gold? It is the purple gold. And if you don't think it is purple gold for us, if we could have a pipe from here, send all the recycled water, tertiary treated, to Northern Africa or to Persian Gulf, believe me, they'll pay as much as gold for that water. And we have to treat it that way. This publication, which was published in the Green Section Record, in case you're not familiar with, go to usga.org, look under Green Section Record, which is their monthly, is it monthly now?
Twice
a month. Bi-weekly publication in December of 2011. That article is there, which will have much more information, detailed, related to what I had to share with you today, and you will see why I like to refer to it as purple gold. Remember, all the water we have on this beautiful globe, all of it, was exactly the same when whoever you believe created it put in. The number of molecules of water hasn't changed. It's very much like energy. It's neither produced nor destroyed. All that's happening with water on Earth, it just changes its state, you know, vapor, liquid. Unfortunately, because we are using that, during this process, we are constantly losing, again, like energy. Energy is lost due to what? Entropy. Although, because efficiency is not 100%, we always lose some energy. Remember the third law of the thermodynamics? You always lose. The same thing here. We always lose quality because every time we use that water, we degrade its quality. But a drop of water, that molecule of water, the water, sometimes it kind of tantalizes it to think that the water we showered in this morning is probably the water that Cleopatra bathed in, you know. So. Or, don't get too excited, Mark Antony peed in. I don't know. It's up to them. We have to do our share. We have to do our share to keep what Grandpa Adam and Grandma Eve saw. We still have time. I think we have time. And of course, again, recycled water is not the only answer. Water scarcity is a localized problem because of the demographic issues and because of the climatic issues and so on. But definitely is one of the pieces of the puzzle that we should use because guess what? We are still producing more apple than ever. And you are eating them more than ever. And you all know what happens afterward. And in case that doesn't make you think, and by the way, thank you very much for spending your time in the past 30 minutes listening to my stories. But remember, during that time that some of you were probably napping, congratulations, by the way, we all got 8,000 new nieces and nephews. 8,000 in 30 minutes. 8,000 of those. And condolences because 3,000 of uncles and aunts decided to say goodbye. Really reluctantly, but they had to go. So now we have 5,000 new nieces and nephews. And you have got to help them to not only have their apples, but they eat it too. Thank you very much.